Thank you, Brad. Thank you, Zach. I had a premonition. I didn't tell you this. I didn't tell Dr. Lyle. I had a premonition that he was going to ask me to preach this semester. I don't know why, but I just knew it. And so when he came and asked at the beginning of the semester, I had had time already to think about it, you see. And so I said yes, and I'm glad for the privilege to be with you and be able to speak before you. Now, the thing is, I don't know if this is a sermon or not. I'm suspecting it isn't. So it's a talk, or it's perhaps musings. But I invite you to come along with me if you'd like to. We'll see where we go. I do wonder what you and I will learn today. I wonder when we will know what we have learned. You know, the human brain is a marvelous, marvelous creation. Billions of neurons fire every second as we respond to what is happening around us and within us. We think and we feel, and we take a variety of actions, and we learn many things without knowing that we are learning them. Yeah, that's right. I mean, think about driving a car and how you can carry on a conversation, listen to the radio, plan what you will do when you arrive, hopefully pay attention to the road, all within the comfort of your car. You are able to process a great deal of information very quickly and not even know that you are doing that. When you are driving, you see a stop sign ahead of you, and you make instantaneous calculations about how and when to stop. I mean, think about it. You begin to apply the brakes at just the right time and just the right pressure. Doesn't matter if you're going 50, 40, 30, 20. You immediately know when to press the brake, how hard to press it, how long to press it, so that you come to stop at the stop sign. You don't know how you know that, but you know it. Even now, you're listening to my words while changes are taking place in your brain and throughout your body. Your heart rate and your blood pressure are lowering as you sit quietly listening. A thought will come pertaining to what is being said, or perhaps a random thought, which you quickly process and file away. You hear certain sounds in the room, and you take note, and then you go back to relaxing, focusing on what I'm saying. You do all of this in one area of your brain, while another area focuses and relaxes. Isn't it amazing and delightful that we are able to do this? You know, Jesus was aware of our abilities to learn in this way, and he taught by speaking to different areas of our brain. Sometimes he used reason. Sometimes he spoke poetry. Sometimes he was clear, and other times he was creatively vague. And he told stories, and he asked questions. And sometimes he was very serious, and sometimes he was humorous. And I wonder what will happen today. Now, the field of psychology has contributed much to our understanding of human beings. In fact, the word psychology means the study of the soul, and so describes the attempt to understand the whole person, beliefs, behaviors, values, emotions, motivations, imagination, relationships, development. You and I are quite complex. We are complex in structure, what comprises us, our various parts. We are complex in function, the relationship of those parts to each other. Again, even now, as you are listening to me, there are parts of your brain that are deciphering the language, other parts that are attempting to comprehend what is being said. There are parts of you that are judging the value of my words, and still other parts that are attempting to connect the information to other learning, to find ways to make application. But this is just a small part of what is happening. You have your bodily feelings, your emotions that you are processing as well. Perhaps emotions connected to what you're hearing or emotions that you have brought with you today. Your feelings, bodily feelings, of which you can so easily become aware, are things that you are processing as well. You are aware of sitting. You are aware of what it feels like to relax, to focus. Aware of what it feels like to listen. You're aware of whether you feel hungry or whether you're satisfied, whether you're tired or whether you're energized. And all of your bodily sensations are used together with a myriad of conscious and unconscious thoughts and feelings to interpret the overall experience of being here. It's a complex set of processes. We are many parts attempting to coordinate structure and functioning. Now, psychology is comprised of many theories about all these various structures and how these structures function and relate to each other. And these theories, though often very diverse, all acknowledge that we are very complex and that our sense of complexity is often hidden from us. We tend to function within a narrow set of primarily conscious processes and interpret the world and who we are in the world through a rather narrow lens. Psychologists speak of the ego as that rational, conscious part of ourselves whose primary goal is to help us to get along in the real world and give us a sense of identity. Now, while I wouldn't equate the ego with a part of the brain, the ego functions much like the left brain. You're familiar with that? Left brain, right brain. You know, the left brain deals with kind of facts. That's your left brain. And your right brain is left to do the more creative, abstract, emotional thinking. You might say that your left brain has a bigger ego than your right brain. Your ego is so wedded to its way of thinking that it may find other ways of thinking to be threatening, or at the very least, uncomfortable. In our Western, more scientific mindset, we tend to give more credence to left brain ego thinking, and so we are culturally supported in developing that way of functioning. Now, of course, the artists and musicians among us may be described as functioning more in the right brain, but they still have a very conscious ego that directs at least part of the artistic process. The artist is right in thinking artistically, but must express the art in the real world by manipulating clay or paint, or in the case of a musician, to perform the technical manipulations involved in playing an instrument. The artist thinks artistically, but the ego gives art its concrete expression. Now, I could go on to describe other parts of the human psyche, most of which are primarily, if not exclusively, unconscious. The unconscious. Now, that's an interesting idea. The very idea of the unconscious, though universally accepted, is something hard for Western mindset to take seriously. We may all give assent to the idea that there's an unconscious, but rarely do we give it much thought. We would rather, for example, think of a dream as just a dream rather than something more revealing. Sometimes a dream may disturb us. Sometimes a dream may delight us. Many times we don't remember our dreams. And rarely do we view dreams as coming from ourselves. Dreams are often experienced as things that happen to us rather than come from us. And dreams are often difficult to interpret, if we should even bother to try. Now, all of this is to say that you and I are very complex, but we fail to experience our complexity. We so often function out of a very limited number of structures. We have strengths and resources that are rarely, if ever, known or utilized. We have parts of ourselves that we would rather not face, and we'll use various conscious and unconscious mechanisms to keep many of those parts outside of our own acknowledgement, let alone acceptance. Of course, we all the more want to hide certain parts of ourselves from others. But I would have you ponder these questions. Is God's call on our life to keep certain things hidden and separate, or is it to bring together the parts of ourselves into a whole? Is wholeness something spiritual, and does it involve identifiable structures and functions of human psychology? Is God working among and through the myriad psychological and spiritual processes to do his unique transforming work within us? Now about Nicodemus. You were wondering if I was going to get to the Bible passage, weren't you? Okay. Or there. Nicodemus was a teacher of the law. He dealt with religious beliefs. He conveyed religious information to others. That was his job. As sincere as his piety may have been, it seemed that in many ways his religion was reduced to a formula, a set of carefully crafted beliefs and practices. Notice the effect that Jesus' statement had on Nick. You must be born again. Now, Nick had to confront the seeming illogic of that statement. Now, he's being pretty concrete here. What are you saying? Can a man enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Now, that response reeks of Freudian Oedipal conflict, but we won't go there. It also reveals what Jesus knew about Nick. Nick needs to become aware of his capacity to think differently about how God and humans relate. Now, I'm convinced that Jesus tailored his statement of a new birth for Nicodemus to produce an absurd response that revealed the limits of Nick's thinking. Now, we might have wanted to respond to Nick's illogic question with a sarcastic, of course you can't be physically born again. However, Jesus is content that Nick has confronted himself with illogic. And at that moment, Nick's brain was searching for some understanding, some kind of response, some connection with prior learning that might make sense and save him from his absurd semi-conclusion. When we are confronted with illogic or ways of thinking that is outside our experience, we often find ourselves momentarily confused and unbalanced and open to something, to anything that might bring back a sense of equilibrium and stability. It was at that point of openness that Jesus said to him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." And to make this idea as concrete as possible for poor, confused, and searching Nick, Jesus states a simple truism. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Now, that he could grasp. That makes sense. It's clear. It feels good to be again in the world of sense-making. Now, Jesus has Nick's attention, and he continues by drawing on what Nick already knows, not from his study of law or his religious practice, but from everyday life, the simple truth that the wind blows. The wind blows. The wind comes and goes. The wind has no boundaries, and though we can feel it, we have no control over it. We simply have to adjust to its blowing. And so it is with the Spirit. Now, these simple statements of flesh is flesh, spirit is spirit, the wind blows, serve to bring Nick to a place of clear understanding, a place where Nick is now more comfortable and also more open to possibilities. He has gone from a place of relative certainty to absurdity to confusion to searching to disequilibrium and finally back to something that makes sense. And such a journey as that requires ways of thinking beyond what is typical. You see, psychologists call this divergent thinking, creative problem solving, thinking outside of the box. However, this psychological and spiritual journey didn't answer all the questions. It raised new ones, but the new questions are not absurdities, like Nick's response about the inaccessibility of a uterus. Nick's next question is much simpler but more profound. How can this be? How can this be? He acknowledges it, you see, as a possibility. What was illogical moments before is now implicitly accepted. He now wants to know how it can happen. Jesus' intervention with Nick created an openness to learn new things in new ways. Jesus taught Nick, in an unexpected way, alternative ways to think of which Nick was perfectly capable. He just needed the spirit wind to blow. But still more is needed than the ego making rational sense of it all. The aim here isn't that Nick leads with a new set of propositions to believe in or to refute. No, Nick needs more than that. So Jesus confronts his very identity. Are you a teacher of Israel and you don't understand this? And then Jesus declares that we speak of what we know. You see, Nick needs experience, not a formula. Nick needs what you and I need, an understanding that we are more than we think, and an experience of the Spirit blowing through us like the four winds gathering together all aspects of our being into a whole. This is the nature of the Spirit. He creates, he divides, he unites. We are, as mere humans, complex beyond our understanding, and yet we function in very limited ways. How much more we can become when the spirit wind blows. Jesus was a master at drawing people to draw from themselves. In the next chapter of John is the story of the woman at the well. It's another great example of meeting somebody where they are, guiding them to a place they could never imagine, all by utilizing that which they already possess. We don't have time to fully analyze this encounter today, but I remind you of the story that you know so well. It's in the middle of the day, and it's hot, and Jesus is sitting by a well when a woman comes to draw water. He simply asks her for a drink, a simple, concrete, rational request. Jesus then suggests the existence of another kind of water that lives and wells up on its own. She eventually perceives that the conversation has moved to a more metaphorical and perhaps religious level, and recognizing Jesus as a Jew takes the opportunity to ask about the mountain of God and who should be worshiping on it. This woman's thinking went from the depth of a well to the top of a mountain. And when Jesus abruptly brings her back down to earth and into her very life, she knew something profound was happening. The spirit wind was blowing. If we approach God in very rigid ways, he tends to respond by calling forth other aspects of ourselves. Conscious, rational approaches often hide more emotional, unconscious resources, and vice versa. A more piously presented self often compensates for a hidden, shadowy side that needs to be acknowledged and integrated so that good and evil are adequately addressed in our lives. Watch for how the spirit wind blows. In closing, I would like to draw your attention to the window that we know so well behind me. It's comprised of many parts and many shapes and many colors. Each part contributes to the whole, and apart from the whole are whole parts. And we search the parts to find the whole, while the whole leads us to the parts. When I look at that window, my gaze tends to focus on the rounding lines that I assume represent the earth. The lines help to create a mandala-like symbol showing how the parts are interconnected to form a whole. It's mostly a static depiction of a cross and a Bible, but there is movement with the bird in flight. The spirit flies. Spirit wind blows. God's spirit bearing witness with our spirit. The Christian mystics were the church psychologists of the day, and so I'll end with a quote from one of my favorite 16th century mystics, Teresa of Avila. She wrote, "God gave us faculties of the soul and mind for our use. Each of them will receive its proper reward. Then do not let us try to charm them to sleep, but permit them to do their work until divinely called to something better." Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for the complexity of our creation. That there is so much more to discover. We ask that your spirit wind blows, that it gathers together those parts of ourselves, and that we have the courage to face those parts. The parts that are good, the parts that are not so good. The lighted parts, the darkened parts. Because they all make up who we are, and who we are in you. Transform us little by little into the image of your Son, and help us to trust in that process, to let it happen, and make us wise guides of that process in others. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.